Today, we are going to have a brief look at gastroretentive drug delivery systems. Before we move on to understanding what is a gastroretentive system, let us first look into brief the need for these systems. All of us know that the oral route of drug delivery is still the most preferable route because of ease of dosing, patient compliance and flexibility in formulation. At the same time, in order to decrease the frequency of oral dosing and to maintain almost steady state plasma levels, controlled release systems have been designed which help in releasing the drug over a long period of time. Okay. So, when administered orally, such delivery systems reach the stomach and they start releasing the drug, and they release the drug for a long period of time as they transit throughout the GI tract until the remnants are excreted. However, such controlled release drug delivery systems have several drawbacks. Let us see what those drawbacks are. The drug that is encased in such a delivery system should be such that it is uniformly absorbed throughout the GI tract. The absorption of drug depends on a number of physicochemical factors as well as biological factors, and the drug is not uniformly absorbed throughout the GI tract. This is because of reasons such as inherent solubility of the drug. The solubility of the drug is dependent on the pKa of the drug and is influenced by the pH of the gastric environment, because of which it is seen that the drug is predominantly absorbed from selective regions of the GI tract. So, the pH of the environment influences the solubility of the drug. Many a times the stability of the drug is also pH dependent, and therefore extreme variations in pH which are experienced by the drug as it travels from the stomach to the colon will affect the stability of the drug. The drug is susceptible to enzymes that it encounters in the GI tract, and therefore it may be inactivated before it is absorbed. Physiological mechanisms such as the mechanism of absorption or distribution or metabolism will affect the availability of the drug from the controlled release delivery system. Also, the presence of microbial flora in a large way influences the degradation pattern of the drug. Finally, the intestinal metabolic enzymes have a very big role to play in determining whether the drug is available and is stable and will be absorbed. The efflux mechanism by which the drug as it enters the cell is immediately thrown out of the cell is another important factor which is responsible for the failure of many controlled release drug delivery systems. Remember, such controlled release drug delivery systems are those that are given orally and those that travel through the GI tract, and they encounter various environments, and there are various reasons why they are ineffective. Another important observation is that generally the drug encounters what is called as an absorption window where maximum amount of drug is absorbed. Before this region and after this region, the amount of drug that is absorbed is minimal, because of which it is necessary that the drug remains at the absorption window region for a long period of time. And in order to bring this into reality, one of the approaches that can be used is to ensure that the drug remains in the stomach for a long period of time, from where it is gradually released and it passes through the entire GI tract and it is absorbed in the region of its absorption window, thus prolonging the gastric retention of a delivery system is desirable for achieving greater therapeutic benefit of the drug. Drugs that are absorbed in the proximal part of the gastrointestinal tract and drugs that are less soluble or degraded in the alkaline pH are benefited by being available and residing in this acidic region for a longer period of time. This will also help to reduce the dose size. Thus, for local and sustained drug delivery to the stomach and the proximal part of the small intestine for treating certain conditions, this prolonged gastric retention of the drug offers several advantages, including improved bioavailability, therapeutic efficacy, and possible reduction in the dose size. Hence, this has led to the approach of gastroretentive drug delivery systems for retaining the drug in the stomach for a longer period of time. We are here going to discuss four different approaches for gastroretention, and those are the use of floating drug delivery systems which will float on top of the gastric juices, mucoadhesive drug delivery systems which are shown here and which will adhere to the mucosal wall of the stomach, high density systems which will sink to the bottom and will be engulfed in the folds of the stomach, and finally the swelling system which swells and thereby is retained in the stomach for a long period of time. As we go ahead, we will look at each of these technologies in detail. Thus, I repeat, controlled drug delivery systems which possess the ability of being retained in the stomach are called as gastroretentive drug delivery systems. They continuously release the drug prior to the absorption window wherever it is and thus ensure maximum bioavailability. So, which are those drugs which can be designed into gastroretentive drug delivery systems? All those drugs which are locally active in the stomach, such as misoprostol or antacids, etc., those drugs which have a narrow absorption window in the gastrointestinal tract and therefore need to pass through that absorption region at a very slow rate, such as L-DOPA or para-aminobenzoic acid, furosemide, riboflavin, etc. Drugs that are unstable in the lower region of the GI tract and therefore need to be retained in the region such as stomach for a longer period of time. Such drugs include captopril, ranitidine hydrochloride, metronidazole, etc. Those drugs which disturb the normal colonic microflora, such as antibiotics, and therefore need to be absorbed before they reach the colon. Drugs that exhibit low solubility at high pH values that are found in the intestine and the colon, such as diazepam, chlordiazepoxide, verapamil, etc. Drugs which are unsuitable for stomach-specific drug delivery systems. Drugs that have very limited acid solubility that dissolve slowly in the acid and therefore need to be retained for a long period of time so that they are absorbed slowly. Drugs that suffer instability in the gastric environment and therefore they need to be protected from the gastric environment, and drugs intended for selective release in the colon and therefore have to pass very slowly through the colon. All such drugs can be designed into stomach specific drug delivery systems, namely the gastroretentive drug delivery systems. What are the advantages of gastroretentive drug delivery systems? Enhanced bioavailability, sustained drug delivery if necessary, reduction in the frequency of dosing, targeted therapy for all ailments of the upper GI tract, reduction in the fluctuations of drug concentration in the plasma, improved selectivity in receptor activation, reduced counter activity of the body, extended effective concentration over a prolonged period of time, and minimized adversity activity at the colon. However, these systems have certain disadvantages. Drug substances which are unstable in the acidic pH of the stomach cannot be incorporated into these systems. This is because these systems are designed to be retained in the stomach, that is at a highly acidic pH. Those systems which require a high level of fluid in the stomach for drug delivery to float and work efficiently may not always be successful in performing their activity. This is because the gastric emptying leads to reduction in the volume of gastric fluid and it again gets refilled after some time. Hence, fluctuations in gastric fluid levels are there, and because of which systems which swell or which are designed to float may not function efficiently. Such systems are not suitable for those drugs that have solubility problems or stability problems in the gastric acid environment of the GI tract. It is not suitable for those drugs which are irritant to the gastric mucosa. Also, it has been seen that such systems do not offer any significant advantage over conventional dosage forms which are absorbed throughout the GI tract. Thus, the design of such gastroretentive drug delivery systems is mandated and is beneficial only in very few cases of drugs, those that do not fall within these limitations. The very first type of drug delivery system which we are going to look at are called as the floating drug delivery systems or the low density drug delivery systems. These systems have a bulk that density that is lower than that of gastric fluid and therefore remain buoyant in the stomach without affecting the gastric emptying rate for prolonged periods of time. The system floats on the top of gastric contents and the drug is released slowly at a desired rate into the GI fluid from this system. Once the drug is released, then the empty residual system is emptied from the stomach. So this results in an increased gastroretention time as well as a better control of the plasma drug level concentration. However, besides a minimal gastric content that is needed for buoyancy, a minimal level of floating force is also required so that the dosage form floats for a long period of time on the surface. Such floating drug delivery systems are divided into the non-effervescent type of systems and the effervescent type of systems. Such effervescent type of systems are also called as gas generating systems. We will first look at the non-effervescent type of systems. There are two examples of non-effervescent type of systems. One is the colloidal gel barrier system and the other is called as the microporous compartment system. These colloidal gel barrier systems swell after swallowing once they are wetted because of imbibition of gastric fluid and therefore they remain floating because their density decreases. Such a system consists of the drug, the polymer such as polycarbophyll or polyacrylate as well as a highly swellable hydrocolloid, an example of which is cellulose. When such a system is administered orally, it comes in contact with the gastric fluid, the polymer hydrates and greatly swells and in doing so entraps the air. Such formulations are simple to manufacture and they are either a single layer tablet or bilayered tablets. There is an immediate release layer which will release the initial dose, thereby bringing the plasma level to the effective concentration, and a subsequent sustained release layer which forms a gel on the surface. The drug inside this gel layer gradually diffuses out, dissolves and maintains the plasma levels for prolonged period of time, and also helps the drug to be absorbed at its absorption window region. The second type of system, which is the microporous compartment system, consists of a drug reservoir with a flotation chamber on top. The drug reservoir is encapsulated inside a microporous compartment and the flotation chamber contains entrapped air. So once administered orally, the system, because of its lower density, floats on the top of gastric contents. The next type of non-effervescent floating drug delivery system that we are going to look at is alginate beads. These are multi-unit floating systems which are based on beads that are cross-linked. Let us see how these are cross-linked. In this approach, an aqueous solution of sodium alginate is dropped into an aqueous solution of calcium chloride, leading to the precipitation of calcium alginate in the form of beads. Such beads are separated and then freeze-dried, giving rise to a porous system which can maintain the floating force for more than 12 hours. These beads have been reported to improve the gastric retention time of the drug by around 6 hours or more. Next, we look at hollow microspheres. Hollow microspheres are loaded with the drugs and prepared by simple solvent evaporation or solvent diffusion techniques, and these help to prolong the gastric retention time of the dosage form. The most commonly used polymers in such cases are polycarbonate, cellulose, acetate, calcium alginate, eudragit, agar, etc. This concept of hollow microspheres is explained here with the help of an example where there are two phases, the aqueous phase, which is PVA dissolved in water and forms the dispersion medium, and the organic phase, which consists of a combination of the solvents ethanol and dichloromethane, in which both the drug and polymer are dissolved. The organic phase is dispersed in the form of small globules in the aqueous phase, and the entire system is heated to 40 degrees centigrade. At 40 degrees centigrade, ethanol diffuses out of the individual globules, and this is followed by evaporation of dichloromethane from the globules. So what is left behind is a hollow core which is surrounded by the drug and coated by the polymer. Thus, we have a system which is lighter than the contents of the gastrointestinal fluid, and this floats on the top of the gastrointestinal fluid. These beads, tiny beads, are then packed into capsules and the capsules are administered to the patient. We now look at different types of effervescent floating systems. These are classified into two major types, the gas generating systems and the volatile liquid containing systems. In the gas generating systems, effervescent agents including sodium bicarbonate, calcium carbonate, tartaric acid and citric acid are used in combination with hydrophilic polymers. When this system comes into contact with the gastric fluid, this results in liberation of carbon dioxide due to the effervescent reaction, and the liberated carbon dioxide, which is entrapped in the hydrocolloid matrix, that is the polymeric matrix, provides buoyancy to the tablet and enables the tablet to float on top of the system. Okay, such systems can be single layered systems or they can be multiple layered systems where the acid is present in one layer and the base is present in another layer and the drug is contained in one of the layers. Okay, so these gas generating systems can be designed as single layer systems or multiple layer systems. The next type of system is that in which volatile liquids are enclosed in the delivery system, and upon administration these volatile liquids volatilize and thereby reduce the density, increase the buoyancy and enable floating of the systems. Common examples of volatile liquids that are used include ether and cyclopentane. Here you can see an example of a system that consists of a volatile liquid. The whole system is enclosed within a capsule. When this capsule is administered to the patient, as it enters the GI fluid, the gelatin shell of the capsule dissolves, releasing the system inside the body. Now this system has two compartments. One compartment which is the drug reservoir, and adjacent to it is the compartment which contains the volatile liquid. So on one side the drug reservoir is enclosed by a compartment consisting of the volatile liquid, and on the other side is present a bioerodible polymer filament through which the drug will be gradually released. As the gelatin shell opens and releases the system into the body, the volatile liquid volatilizes at body temperature, therefore rendering the system less dense as compared to the gastrointestinal fluids and more buoyant. This chamber may be filled either with volatile liquid or may be vacuum or inert gas. We next look at the mucoadhesive type of systems, or what are also called as bioadhesive systems. These systems are intended to extend the gastric retention time by adhering to the gastric mucosal membrane. They adhere onto the soft tissues of the lining of the GI tract. The adhesion of the polymer with the mucus is mediated by hydration, bonding, or maybe receptor mediated. As you can see, the major function of such mucoadhesive systems should be that it should be able to bind to the gastric epithelial cell surface or the mucin layer surrounding the epithelial cell surface. The advantage of such systems is that they improve the residence time of the dosage in the GI tract, mainly the stomach, and they improve the chances of absorption from the absorption window or absorption region. Selection of the mucoadhesive polymer is very critical here, as it is the major reason why we can formulate such a system that remains in the stomach and releases the drug slowly, such that the drug can pass through the absorption region and be absorbed to the maximal extent. Therefore, the mucoadhesive polymer should be non-toxic, non-absorbable from the GI tract, it should be non-covalently bound to the mucin or the epithelial surface. It should be such that it can easily incorporate the drug. At the same time, it should not hinder release of the drug from the delivery system. Also, mucoadhesive polymer should be capable of binding to specific sites on the mucin or epithelial surface, and they should be cost effective. So, the mechanisms that are involved in mucoadhesion are hydration, van der Waals interaction, hydrogen bonds, and binding to receptors. Because these systems are designed to bind to the mucus or the epithelial surface, the major drawback of such a system is that the efficiency of the system depends upon the turnover of the mucus. Also, if the mucus is soluble, then the system will not bind and remain at one position for a long time. It will be washed off with the soluble mucus. The most promising approach to achieving gastroretention is that of creating swelling system in situ. Such systems are also called as plug type of systems. The principle of gastric retention in these systems is due to excessive hydration and swelling, leading to the formation of a plug that remains lodged at the pyloric sphincter. Okay, so here a system, matrix type of system consisting of a hydrocolloid polymer that can swell in the presence of water is used. This system is small when it is administered, but upon entering the stomach, it takes up water, appreciable quantity of water, and it swells to such a size that it remains lodged at the pyloric sphincter and does not pass through. The degree to which polymer swells is determined by the extent of cross-linking. An optimum cross-linking should be done to maintain a balance between swelling as well as dissolution required. Remember, if the system has an excessive degree of cross-linking, it will neither swell nor will it allow the drug to diffuse out. Therefore, optimum cross-linking is necessary to enable both swelling as well as release and dissolution of the drug. The system should have sufficient rigidity to remain intact in the stomach and to withstand the mechanical forces therein. Also, it should gradually decrease in size after it has released all the drug and then be able to pass through the intestines and be excreted. The degree of swelling or expansion or unfolding is very, very critical. Lastly, we come to the high density systems. These are systems that are designed in such a way that they get lodged in the folds or the rugae of the stomach and are able to withstand the peristaltic movements of the stomach. Such systems have a density of 1.3 grams per ml or greater, and the formulation of such heavy pellets is based on the assumption that the pellets would be positioned in the lower part of the stomach because they have high density and they will sink through and be retained in the rugae of the stomach. Thus, systems with a density greater than 1.3 gram per ml or 3 gram per centimeter cube are generally found to be retained well and are able to withstand the peristaltic movements. So, these are simple tablets or matrix type of delivery systems wherein heavy diluents are used. So, which are those diluents that can be used to make such high density systems? These include barium sulfate, zinc oxide, titanium dioxide or iron powder. In conclusion, to derive maximum benefit from certain drug substances, it is necessary to prolong their gastric residence time. Also, where the delivery system should exhibit a burst followed by a sustained release of the active ingredient, such technology can be used to develop gastro-retentive drug delivery systems. At the same time, development of such systems requires a thorough understanding of gastrointestinal physiology as well as the physicochemical properties of the drug substances. Different approaches having their own advantages and disadvantages have been worked upon and reviewed and reported in literature. Floating, bioadhesive and swelling systems are promising gastroretentive delivery systems that have been reported. Also, to avoid the disadvantages of gastroretentive approaches, combination of gastroretentive approach with some other approach has been found to be greatly beneficial in better gastric retention and improved efficiency of the treatment. Nevertheless, there are opportunities and great potential for developing more effective gastroretentive delivery systems. We now move on to the evaluation of these gastroretentive delivery systems. Depending upon the dosage form in which they are formulated, whether it is tablet or it is capsule, all the tests that are mentioned for the conventional tablets and capsules in the pharmacopoeias need to be performed on these delivery systems. In addition, certain tests, specialized functional tests, also need to be performed on these systems. For example, let us go to the floating drug delivery systems. For such systems, it is critical to know the time for which the delivery system can float in the gastric fluid. For this purpose, floating time, that is the time for which the dosage form floats in 900 ml of 0.1 normal HCl at 37 degrees is to be noted. Similarly, specific gravity, which gives an idea of the buoyancy as well as the extent of flotation, needs to be measured. Here, the displacement method can be used by using benzene as the displacing medium. Similarly, the buoyancy, value of buoyancy in terms of the total force required for the system to move upwards, can be measured. If the value of F is positive, then buoyancy is greater and the object is able to float. If we design a mucoadhesive system which is supposed to adhere to mucin or the epithelial cells of the stomach, then the mucoadhesive strength of such a system has to be measured. For this purpose, the delivery system is wetted and it is pressed between two layers of membrane, suitable membrane, and the force required to separate the delivery system or the polymer in question is measured. Swelling systems are those systems which consist of a hydrophilic colloid which will absorb a lot of water and which will swell. For such systems, these systems are weighed initially and they are allowed to swell in the presence of water. The weight gained and the dimensional change is noted. Also, in all these systems, the extent of gastroretention can be visualized in vivo by using X-ray technique or by using gamma scintigraphy. Lastly, it is important to carry out dissolution testing in different media to understand the profile of drug being released in the stomach as well as the drug that is likely to be released at a higher pH. So, with this I conclude the topic of gastroretentive drug delivery systems, and for reference and complete reading, refer to the book Progress in Controlled and Novel Drug Delivery Systems by N.K. Jain. Thank you.